We have another one word title for our lesson. Last week it was hate, and we talked about hate, and we talked about how hate should not be among us, and if you were here, you heard that, and if not, you can find it very soon in our YouTube channel. But today I want to talk to us about fear, and this is probably, as I was looking back through my lesson histories, this is probably going to be the third time that we've talked about fear in some way. Hopefully you'll find today's to be a little bit different, with a little bit of a different twist to it than in the last couple times that we read through this. But when we look at Job and what was so well read for us just a few moments ago, in Job, again, chapter 3, there in verse 24 through 26, get over there to it and read that again. "For my sighing comes before I eat, my groanings pour out like water. For the thing I greatly feared has come upon me, and what I dreaded has happened to me. I am not at ease, nor am I quiet. I have no rest, for trouble comes." When we think about our world today, we see a people throughout this world. Many people are consumed by fear. And Job speaks to this idea of being afraid of certain things. And when you think about what has happened to Job, when you think about all the things that had been taken away from him, his family and his health, those are the sorts of the things that we worry about. And when we, as we grow older and as we go through life, we know that it may happen in our lifetime that our close family and friends may leave this earth before us. We understand that they may pass away. They may become sick. We may become sick. We may have some ailment that decreases our quality of physical life. And many people fear that. In fact, if we're honest with ourselves, there's a little bit of that trepidation about those things in all of us, no matter what. But it's something that doesn't have to be consuming. We can look forward to something with dread. We might, when we're younger and we're in school, we might look forward to a test in dread. But hopefully it doesn't consume us, and we can look forward with hope that we've studied the material. We can look forward with hope that we understand the concepts that are being tested, and that we can go into that test with some comfort. The same thing in our lives as Christians. We can look towards the end of life. We can look towards the things that might happen to us in life, and it might make us feel a certain way. You might get a feeling in the pit of your stomach when thinking about that. Your head might swirl a little bit in thinking about those things. But when we understand that we are prepared, when we understand that we have looked into the word of truth, and that we have come away with a knowledge of who Christ is, and we have been obedient to him as he has commanded, when we have those things, then we can approach those things in life that would make us fearful otherwise. Unfounded fear often creates a self-fulfilling prophecy of sorts. We're so afraid of something, we spend our time cowering away from certain parts of life, that it becomes true. Perhaps we're afraid of confrontation. Perhaps we're afraid to speak to our neighbor or our friend about Christ because they might not take it well. They might slam the door in our face. Well, if we sit there and mull over what could happen, and we spend all of our time thinking about those things, then, well, it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy, because you probably won't go knock on the door. You probably won't say the things that need to be said when you see them and when you have the opportunity. And that's many other lessons in and of itself. you know, how to talk to others. We always, as individuals, are working to get better at that. But this comfort of knowing of a common hope in Christ that we have with all the other saints in the world can really quell all of those fears to the point where we might not understand what might happen. I mean, which one of us really knows what it's like to pass from this life into eternity? If you're sitting here and you have breath in your body, you don't really know. You can speculate, and we had a lesson some time ago about what happens when I die. And in the scriptures, we find certain hints as to what might happen when we pass away from this life. But there's going to be that uncertainty, but it should not turn into a fear that cripples us. You know, there's again that comfort in Christ. I'm reminded, as I was preparing for this lesson, I was reminded of some friends of ours, a preacher that my family and I know, whose parents, or his wife's parents, passed away in 2017. They had been married for 77 years, and they passed away within 30 hours of each other. The husband passed away, and the wife was, you know, doing as well as she could for that time in her life, but she was so missing her husband that she passed away of what was often called broken heart syndrome within 30 hours of her husband's passing. As I looked that up, I wanted to refresh my memory of how many years they had been married and so on, and so I looked that up online, and it's surprising how many others there are. There were many articles from USA Today and so on telling of people that had a similar circumstance after having been married for many years. You know, and it's that comfort that they had taken in each other in this life. But in a much bigger way, we have a comfort in Christ. Being separated from Him should cause us to long for nothing else, and to make that be the focus of our lives, to not be separated from Him. Now, in this particular case, these two people that I was speaking of were solid Christians. In fact, the husband had preached for many years and was a very, very faithful Christian by all accounts. And I have no doubt that they are in a place of comfort. But as we think about fear, we realize that we start putting two and two together, that it is a wonderful tool of Satan. It is the devil's distraction, if you will. You know, even if our loved ones are outside of Christ and they pass away, we can't afford ourselves, we can't afford to be crippled by fear when they do pass or leading up to their passing. We can't afford to be crippled by fear of the what ifs that may happen in our lives. You know, when we look a little bit further forward in Job, in fact, at the end of the book of Job, Job 42, let's read the first six verses of that last chapter of Job. Job 42, verse 1 says, "Then Job answered the Lord and said, 'I know that you can do everything, and that no purpose of yours can be withheld from you. You asked, who is this who hides counsel without knowledge? Therefore I have uttered what I did not understand, things too wonderful for me, which I did not know. Listen, please, and let me speak. You said, I will question you, and you shall answer me. I have heard of you by the hearing of the ear, but now my eye sees you. Therefore, I abhor myself and repent in dust and ashes.'" Job had looked back at all of the things that he had said, of all of the things that he was worried about, that he let himself become so overcome with the fear, if you will, of these things that would befall him. that, you know, so much so that he wished for death. And he looks back at these things and he realizes that I didn't know what I was talking about, because you, God, are able. And my hope is in you. And all of these things that have befallen me, you know, they basically mean nothing in the end. He realized his foolishness in his fear and doubting. And as you read on the last bit of the last chapter there, chapter 42, you read about Job's final prosperity, if you will, the things that the Lord blessed him with, you know, twofold of the things that he lost. And he came out better than he was in the beginning. But regardless of those physical things, as Christians, as those seeking after Christ, we need to be those that are looking for that hope and that treasure in heaven. And we need not be fearful of the things which may befall us on this earth. We can turn on the television and we can look at all of the things that are going on in this world, the wars, the destruction, the mean, awful things that happen to people. I am somewhat of, as you know, a news junkie, and I listen to the news pretty regularly. And just in our local area, it seems as though there are people shooting each other every day. There are people robbing each other and hurting each other. And I hear of those things, and those things can get into our mind and cause us to be fearful of everything. But in the end, what is our hope founded in? What do we have to be fearful of, you know, when we stop and really think about it, if we have Christ? You know, there's a good kind of fear, and fear can have a good effect on us in some ways. It's good to have a godly fear. It's good to have a healthy fear of those things that can kill you, to put it one way. You know, when we're young, we're taught to be afraid of the things that can harm us. In fact, many of the nursery rhymes and fables and so on that you heard as children were designed to instill within children that there are dangers in the world, you know, like the big bad wolf and so on. And so, you know, that's a good thing to have children realize that there are dangers in the world. And it's good for us to realize that there are dangers in the world and dangers to our soul in the world. And we can have a healthy fear of the Lord, which helps us to realize that there are these dangers. But again, we don't want to have that crippling fear. The Lord isn't seeking for us to be crippled in his sight, but to be empowered, to be strengthened by the hope that we have in him. But make no mistake, when we stand before him in judgment, if we have not been faithful, it will be the other way around. You know, Proverbs 28 and verse 14 says, "Blessed is the one who fears the Lord always, but whoever hardens his heart will fall into calamity." Now, there is just great wisdom in Proverbs. You just read through Proverbs, and it's just one gift after another in the way of wisdom. But we need to seek to have that godly fear, an understanding that God is eternal, and the thing that he has power over is so much greater than an illness has power over our body, and so much greater than any person who seeks to do us harm can have power over. You know, those things are fleeting. You know, our life on this earth is fleeting, but our souls are eternal, and God is in control of our souls. We are either with him or we're not. We've been obedient to him or we haven't. And if we haven't, then we should have that fear of where we might end up, where we will end up if we haven't been obedient to him. If we are faithful, then we have that godly fear and understanding who he is and what his power is. But that's not a fear of cowering. That's not a fear that causes us to go hide, but it causes us to want to come closer and closer to Him each and every day. You know, fear of non-eternal things, non-eternal authorities, again, as we mentioned a moment ago, that is just an unhealthy fear. That's not something that we should spend our time worrying about, because we are appointed to die once, and then the judgment. If we live long enough to be taken up with Christ when He returns, well, then so be it. But that's not something that that most people are going to be able to count on throughout history and into the future. We just don't know. So we better prepare and look towards that authority which is eternal. You know, again, all of these things that go on in the world, all of the people that may be out to harm us, all of the wars and the rumors of wars and the things that come about and may come about in our future, they can only kill our body. They can only harm us for a little while. But eternity lies with the Lord. And Matthew 10 at verse 28 reminds us, as we've read it many times before, "And do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear Him who can destroy both soul and body in hell." Kind of puts it into perspective. And again, it's not that cowering fear. You know, the only reason you have to run away and to be afraid is if you're working against that authority. Don't raise your hands, but how many of you, when you're driving down the road and a police officer appears behind you, do you get that feeling in the pit of your stomach? Do you get a little bit worried about that? We've all probably been there, but when you really stop and think about it, if you make an effort to do what you're supposed to do, if you make an effort to be obedient to the law, you don't have to worry about them. Now, many of you know my former work as a driving school instructor and owner, and I've told you before about my times where the state patrol would come in and inspect us. And I had grown comfortable with the authority of the police and of the state highway patrol, because I didn't have anything to fear in them. I was trying to do everything according to the book. I was trying to do everything according to the law. And so when they came in, I was friendly and comfortable and at ease with them. And they felt that. They understood that. Others that I would talk to had horrible experiences because they were so overcome by their fear that, again, they sort of made, again, the self-fulfilling prophecy thing, they sort of made things more difficult for themselves. You know, so as we go through life, you know, there's a life lesson, just very simple, and they just do what you're supposed to do, and you don't have to then live in fear. But spiritually and eternally, just do what you're supposed to do, and then you don't have to live in fear. If you just simply open the book and read what the Lord would have you to do, and it's very simple. You know, there are many in this world that will try to tell us and tell everyone around us just how difficult it is. You have to jump through all these hoops. They add things to the scriptures that are just not there. And they bind those things on men and make it even more difficult until people give up. And then they get into the mix of all these things, that the rituals that are done in the name of the Lord, and they become disgusted because it just doesn't make sense. But the scriptures make sense. It's a very simple path to walk down to be in Christ. But we can't fear the things that will just simply kill our body. We should fear those things that which can destroy us eternally. As we think a little bit further, you know, we know that there are those that just don't have a godly fear. There are those that live their lives as though they fear nothing. They have hardened themselves. Again, looking to the top of the screen, Proverbs 28 at verse 14, the end of that verse, but whoever hardens his heart will fall into calamity. We cause ourselves trouble if we just simply live without fear, because who cares? You know, when I was I told you this not too long ago, I think, when I was a teenager, I had a shirt that was popular 30 years ago or whatever, and it said, "No fear," across the front of it and the back of it. And somebody who is a Christian approached me one day and said, "You probably shouldn't wear that shirt. Do you realize what you're actually saying by saying you have no fear? And what reason do you have to have no fear?" And it just totally went over my head as a teenager. But as I think back on that, there was great wisdom in what they were trying to impart into my head. We have to have a godly fear, as we talked about a few moments ago. But those that have no godly fear, you know, it leads to, again, that irrational fear of everything else. Think about that. If you don't fear God, you know, what's going to come of you? You know, what will eventually seep in? Even the strongest no fear type of people that I've met in my life that have attained old age and still have not sought out the Lord, they tend to become fearful of something. You know, and we can put on a show and say that we don't fear anything, but we know different from being human beings. If our hope is rooted in this life and in the what ifs of life, then it's a very scary thought. Again, thinking of Job, speaking of the things that he feared the most, and they had come true. If we live that way, if we say, "Well, what if? I can't do this because what if? I can't really say anything about the scriptures, and I can't really say anything to my friends because they might be upset, or you know, there might be some kind of a ramification of that." You know, what are we going to do when things get tougher in our life, when we're faced against one of those what if situations? You know, those that live with that mindset of what if, you know, and they carry that too far, it becomes an overpowering fear of everything. Now, we should be able to look forward. I don't want to make the mistake of having you think that I think we shouldn't look forward at all. But as we look forward, we should think, you know, if I do this, then, you know, these consequences may come. We need to think about that a little bit, but we don't need to continually go over it and over it in our head to where it becomes something that cripples us with fear. Now, we need to remember, you know, Job's what ifs. You know, again, back in Job 3, where we were reading at the beginning of this lesson, we read about how he had said that all of those things that he feared came to be. Again, we learn a lesson from Job. We learn a lesson from those that are taught about in the scriptures that feared the wrong things. Or you want to think of it another way, think of those around Noah that did not fear God. What happened to them? Calamity befell them, just as the word says. What happened to Noah, who moved with godly fear? He and his family were saved. As we remember these things, and as we think through the scriptures and think of the things that we've talked about, even this morning we talked about Mary and Martha and Lazarus, but remembering Martha's misplaced fears, the worry about all of the things that needed to be done. But then we realize that her sister was doing things that were of an eternal nature, that were more important. If we go over to Luke chapter 10, we were there again in Bible study this morning, was brought up. Luke chapter 10, verse 41, and this is after the situation where Mary and Martha was worried about her sister not helping, and she was distracted with the comings and goings of serving the food and so on and being hospitable. In verse 41, and Jesus answered and said to her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and troubled about many things, but one thing is needed, and Mary has chosen that good part, which will not be taken away from her." She was seeking after the Lord, very simply. Mary was seeking after Christ. That one thing is still required of us today, and it's the one thing that can't be taken away from us. If we are in Christ and we have been obedient to Him, if we've put His word into our heart, and if we study and we, again, put that word into our heart, even if someone burns the pages of our Bible, they can't take away the word from us. If we have been obedient to Christ and someone kills our body, they can't take away our eternal hope. If they put us in prison and if they do all of the horrible things that mankind does to each other, if those things befall us, they can't take away our hope in Christ if we have sought after Him, diligently sought after Him. As we think on these things and we think of fear and we think of healthy, godly fear, we think of the kind of fear that we see in the world, and we think of what happens if we don't have that healthy, godly fear. It leaves only one question. Are you in Christ today? Are you one that has put on Christ? Do you believe that Jesus is? Do you believe that He is? And have you looked into His word? And having heard His word, your faith has grown? And you understand and are willing to confess Him before men? You understand what must be done in order to be saved? And just like those in Acts chapter 2, on the day of Pentecost, they were buried in the waters of baptism after they were cut to the heart and asked, what must we do to be saved? And they were baptized for the remission of sins. They were raised to walk in that newness of life, and there the rest of eternity began for them as they worked diligently. As you read past Acts chapter 2, the end of Acts chapter 2 and beyond, you read about the church and the people the church growing, and the people seeking after the word and seeking to do the will of the Lord. Are you willing to take those steps? Are you willing to realize that sin separates you from Christ, from the Lord? Are you willing to repent, turning away from those sinful things? And repentance, again, is not an "I'm sorry," but it's a moving with godly fear to walk in a new direction, to walk towards Christ, to, even though we falter from time to time, our focus is on Christ and our hope is in Him, because we have that promise that He's given to us. Are you in Christ today? And if not, won't you make that change today? The waters of baptism are ready behind me. I leave you with just two more thoughts. Ecclesiastes 12, verse 13 says, "The end of the matter, all has been heard. Fear God and keep His commandments, for this is the whole duty of man." And John 14, verse 27 says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid." Again, if you need to put on Christ in baptism, the waters are ready. If you need the prayers of the saints, if we can be a support to you, if we can be a help in a time of trouble, whatever your need may be, please let it be known as we stand and sing.